Thank you, Kamala. Good morning, Kamala. Good morning, Faye. Good morning, Nigel. Good morning to all participants. Welcome to this session. Kamala, thank you very much for the invitation and the introduction you gave me, especially the invitation to be one of the speakers in this already very successful week. I'm really honored to be part of this big event and being able to share with you the introduction of the corporate governance and the code corporate governance for the state-owned enterprises in Curaçao. Allow me to share with you all a PowerPoint presentation I have made. Please tell me if you can see it, Kamala.
Yes, it's clear and nice. Go ahead.
Thank you, Kamala. To start, okay, the PowerPoint is not working. Yes. To start, I'd want to give you an overview of the specific topics I will be elaborating on today. I will start with a brief explanation of the position of Curaçao within the Kingdom of the Netherlands. I will go back in time in the period before 2010. That's the period before the introduction of corporate governance. After that, I will be talking about the mandatory introduction of the Corporate Governance Code for State-Owned Enterprises in 2010. I will be explaining the procedures for the appointment of members of the Supervisory Board and the Board of Directors, and also the procedures for the dismissals of these members according to the Corporate Governance Code. And I will finalize with elaborating a bit on the other rules and aspects of the code corporate governance. As you probably know, Curaçao is still part of the Kingdom of the Netherlands. Knowing the structure of the kingdom and a little bit about the history of the establishment of Curaçao as a country within the Kingdom of the Netherlands will help you understand why corporate governance has been introduced for state-owned enterprises in Curaçao. The Kingdom of the Netherlands used to consist of the Netherlands and the Caribbean part of the kingdom, the country the Netherlands entails, consisting of six islands, the ABC Islands, Aruba, Bonaire, and Curaçao, and the SSS Islands, St. Martin, Seychelles, and Ceiba. As from 1986, Aruba obtained a status as a country within the kingdom, leaving the Netherlands entails. And the kingdom from that point in time consisted of three countries, Aruba, the Netherlands entails, and the Netherlands. After a referendum in Curaçao in 2005 and 2009 on its status within the kingdom, the Curaçao started negotiations with Netherlands to obtain its status as a country within the kingdom, just like Aruba. The Netherlands were willing to honor the voice of the people to obtain the status of a country within the kingdom, but not without very strict conditions. The Netherlands agreed on the debt restructuring of the island by paying 2/3 of the debt of the island and refinancing 1/3 of the debt of the island. The conditions, however, for doing this regarded constraints on the financial autonomy of the island. Strict rules would be applicable on the budget and the finance of the country of Curaçao. Regulations regarding this was put in the Kingdom Act of Financial Supervision. As a part of the financial supervision, this act contained also the obligation of the Council of Curaçao to introduce corporate governance legislation. Article 28 of this act brings the obligation for the new countries, Curaçao and also St. Martin at that point in time, to have legislations on corporate governance that meet international standards, especially on three areas. The three areas were procedures for alienating and obtaining shares in state-owned enterprises by the countries, guidelines for dividend policies of state-owned enterprise in which the countries participated, and also procedures and requirements regarding the appointment and dismissals of members of the supervisory board and members of the board of directors of the state-owned enterprises. Netherlands put these conditions because of the lack of good corporate governance in the past has had financial consequences for the budget of Curaçao. Whenever a state-owned enterprise was having financial problem, the government had to step in to try to save the company and to save jobs. So it was for utmost important for the Netherlands that the governance of the state enterprises would be improved to prevent these companies to get in trouble and having the government to step in again, which would have consequences for the budget of Curaçao. So, as from January 1st, Curaçao must have a legislation regarding corporate governance in accordance with the Kingdom Act. But before telling you about the introduction of the Corporate Governance Code, let me take you back in time to explain how things were before the introduction of the corporate governance with state-owned enterprises in Curaçao. Before 2010, there were no specific formal legislations regarding corporate governance. The guidelines for the companies were stipulated in the Articles of Associations and the Civil Code. On Curaçao, we have the Civil Code and not a common law as a lot of Caribbean countries have. At that point in time, nomination, appointment, and dismissals of the members of the board were not transparent nor tied to standards and procedures. There were no standards for the composition of the supervisory board and no profile for the members of the supervisory board. There were also no procedures for recruitment of the members of the board. Anyone could be appointed as a member of the board. There were no qualification requirements. At that time, I was executive secretary of the Executive Council of Curaçao. Common practice was that political parties forming the government would nominate candidates that would be appointed as members of the supervisory board. They will just give you the names of the candidates with no curriculum vitae, no explanation, whatever. So the company could get new members of the supervisory board that had no knowledge of the work area of the company, had absolutely no management skills or financial insights, nor had skills to supervise and advise the board of directors. It was normal that with the change of government, all members of the supervisory board would be replaced. And as the government of Curaçao could sometimes be very unstable in these times, changes could take place within 2 years, resulting in no continuity and stability in the supervisory board, and mostly resulting in no proper supervision of the managing director. The managing director could go their own way because of lack of proper supervision. Not only the frequent changing of the board, but also because of the lack of expertise in the board, yeah, they were not apt to do the job properly. Before 2010, there was also no regulation for dividend policies and dividend distributions, making it possible for the government, when in need of funds, to use the reserves of the companies for no company-related issues and putting the existence of the companies at risk. Before 2010, there was also a lack of separation of function and responsibilities between the authorities of the supervisory board, the board of directors, the shareholders meeting. But although according to the civil law and the association, the article of associations of the companies, there should be a separation of these powers, that was actually not the case. Civil servants could be members of the supervisory board. Ministers were often the president of the supervisory board, but the minister was also the representative of the shareholders in the shareholders meeting. As a result of this, There was often political involvement in decision-making within the companies. The minister, in his role as a president of the supervisory board, was often inclined to influence the decision-making of the managing director, which was not always in the best interest of the company. There were also conflicts of interest. As there was no regulation preventing a person to be appointed as a member of the supervisory board, so members could be appointed but whose interest was not always the interest of the company. With the introduction of the legislation of corporate governance on January 1st, 2010, Netherlands wanted to put an end to this. The introduction of corporate governance on January 1st, 2010 consisted of three parts. The introduction of the legislation, the ordinance, corporate governance, the institution of the advisor corporate governance, the SBTNO, and the implementation of the code corporate governance for state-owned enterprises. The corporate governance ordinance and the code corporate governance Curaçao is applicable to all corporations which have the statutory seats in Curaçao and of which the shares and the depositary receipts in evidence of shareholding are held by the Council of Curaçao in whole or in part. The Corporate Governance Code is also applicable as much as possible to foundations which the minister is empowered to appoint or dismiss one or more members of the boards, or respective to which the minister has the authority to amend the article of associations. These entities are considered the state-owned enterprises of Curaçao. The ordinance corporate governance has rules and obligations for the government and the ministers. And the code corporate governance has rules and regulations regarding the state-owned enterprises. What are these rules and obligations for the government and the ministers stipulated in the ordinance corporate governance? First, the minister has to empower all state enterprises to comply with the code by making them adapt their articles of associations. The code corporate governance is not a law. That's why they have to make it to adapt the articles of association to make it applicable. The articles of associations of the corporations and foundation should be adapted in such a way to enable as many provisions of the corporate governance codes to become applicable to the company. One of the most important obligations stipulated in the ordinance is that the government had to institute an independent and impartial advisor corporate governance. This advisor would have to advise on any intention of the government or the minister with respect to the following four topics: dividend policies and dividend distributions, the purchasing and selling of shares of the state-owned enterprises, the procedures and profiles for recruitment and selection of the board members. By the board members, I mean the members of the supervisory board and the members of the board of directors, and also procedures regarding the dismissal and removal of the members of the board. The government or the minister cannot take any decisions with respect to these four issues without having received an advice of the advisor. The advisor has to advise within a period of 4 weeks, having received the written intention of the government or the minister. The ordinance stipulates that advisor can have serious objections or no serious objections against the intention or the proposition of a minister regarding these topics. If the advisor has serious objections, the government is actually not allowed to continue with its intention to take a decision unless the government is able to motivate why, despite the serious objections of the advisor, it is necessary to take that specific decision. All the advices of the advisor, but also the written motivation of the minister to deviate from the advice of the advisor, has to be published within 2 weeks on the website of the advisor according to the stipulation of the ordinance. This will give transparency to the decision-making process of the government on the specific topics regarding state-owned enterprises. The local newspapers and the media usually publish the advices of the advisor. Giving transparency to this process puts pressure especially on the government, the ministers and politicians to comply with regulations and especially the regulations regarding the appointment of the members of the supervisory board in compliance with the profile of the board of the profile of the supervisory boards. Let me elaborate a bit on the process and procedures of the appointment of the members of the supervisory board. According to the Corporate Governance Ordinance, before you can appoint a member of the supervisory board, you need to have a profile for the board as a whole, and also a specific profile for each individual member of the board. There also has to be a procedure for the recruitment of the members of the board, and the advisor has to advise upon the profile and the recruitment procedure before the recruitment of the candidates can take place. The advisor also has to advise on the selected candidate to determine if the procedure has been followed and if the candidate really fits the profile. With regard to the profile of the supervisory board, the scope, composition, the nature and size of the corporation and their enterprises shall be taken into account. The profile must, among other things, reflect the nature and activities, the size and the specific risk of the enterprise in medium and long-term view. The supervisory board shall be composed in such a manner as to enable each member of the board to operate independently and critically from one another, as well as from the managing board of directors. The supervisory director, who was appointed on basis of a specific nomination, shall fulfill its task without any mandate from those who nominated him and totally independent from the partial interests that are involved in the enterprise. Meaning, he is also has to be totally independent of politics and the minister that has nominated him. The profile, however, is not static. The supervisory board should assess the profile periodically. Changes in the company, new developments, and new insights can result in the need for adapting the profile of the board, of the supervisory board as a whole, and also the change of members of the board. For instance, if a company in a certain year will have to renegotiate a new collective labor agreement with the union, you want to have a supervisory director with experience and knowledge on that topic. At that point, you will have to change your profile of the supervisory board, and then you can change the member of the supervisory board. The composition of the supervisory board must be based on deliberate choice of quality to ensure the supervisory and advisory task of the supervisory board. Depending on the size and complexity of the company, you should determine the size of the board. Before 2010, all boards of state-owned enterprise on Curaçao used to consist of at least 7 members and sometimes even 11 and 15 members. After the introduction of the code, most boards consist only of 5 members And only the bigger companies, like the utility company, has 7 members in the supervisory board. Some boards even consist of only 3 members. Besides the need of a proper composition of the board, the code determines that each board should have a financial expert. The advice has also advised that each board also must have a legal expert. Depending on the company, the other necessary expertise for the board has to be determined. Not everyone can become a member of the board. There are restrictions. For instance, a member of parliament may not become a member of the board, and so does not the minister or an executive of the government. Why not? Because that minister may have other interests than the interest of the company. The interest of the island could be totally different in certain point of time than the interest of the company. Nor may a civil servant be a member of the supervisory board. This because the civil servant can get instruction of the minister and so be influenced by doing his job, his independent job as a member of the supervisory board. A former managing director of that same company is also not allowed to be a member of the supervisory board within a certain period of time. You can imagine that if a former managing director of that corporation will become a member of the supervisory board within 1 year after his dismissal as a managing director, he could be sitting there in the supervisory board and giving himself discharge of things he has done as a director at the point in time that he was director. A supervisory board member also has to be completely independent and has also to have no conflict of interest with the corporation. It's also not allowed to have any family relationship within the member of boards and the member of the board of director. And the other stipulation is that the supervisory director may not be a supervisory director in more than 5 corporations. This so he will have sufficient time to do his job and task properly in all those corporations. Each candidate to be appointed has to comply with general criteria like certain level of education and level of experience, but they also have to comply with specific criteria stipulated in the profile of each individual member. So for instance, they have to have a master or a bachelor degree in certain area. For instance, in the profile for a legal expert, you can stipulate that a person must have a master's degree in corporate law and must have at least 10 years experience as a corporate lawyer in a certain specific branch. The code actually prescribes that there should be an open and transparent recruitment and selection procedure for the members of the supervisory board. Unfortunately, for the recruitment of the members of the supervisory board, it isn't yet the case in Curaçao. This was just one bridge too far for all politicians. Instead of having a transparent procedure to recruit the candidates, the responsible ministers for the state-owned enterprise still tend to pick and choose their own candidates to be nominated. But they are choosing candidates that fits the profile. And if the advisor advises that there are serious objections against the candidate the minister wants to appoint, the minister usually will withdraw this candidate and propose another candidate that fits the profile. So I'm proud to say that at this moment, all our state-owned enterprises do have supervisory board members that fit the minimum requirements of the profile of the boards of the specific companies. Whenever the minister or the government wants to appoint a board member, he has to notify the advisor in advance and ask the advisor for his advice. The advisor has to advise within a period of 4 weeks. The advisor will judge if the candidate fits the profile and if the provisions of the Articles of Association and Civil Code has been taken into consideration. As I said, if we have serious objection, the minister is allowed to deviate from the advice of the advisor, but he has to set a written motivation to the advisor to do so. This advice and the written motivation of the minister will be published on the website of the advisor within a period of 2 weeks' time. The procedure for the appointment of the member of the board of directors has many similarities with the procedure for the appointment of the members of the supervisory board. But there are some important differences. Although the shareholders' meeting has the right to appoint managing directors just like they have the right to appoint the members of the supervisory board, the procedure for the recruitment and selection of the managing director is done independently by the supervisory board and not the shareholder nor the minister. So there will be no political involvement in the recruitment of the members of the managing board. The procedure has to be totally transparent and objective according to the corporate governance code. For the recruitment and the selection of the supervisory board has to be assisted by an independent and impartial recruitment bureau. The recruitment has to start with the publication of the vacancy in the local newspaper and, depending on the company, also a publication of the vacant function in international media. An assessment of the final candidates is a mandatory part of the procedure as also an integrity screening. The supervisory board with the independent recruitment bureau have to nominate, if possible, two candidates in order of preference to the shareholders meeting. Before taking a decision, the minister should notify again with a written motivation, the advice of its intention to appoint the selected candidate. Let's go to another part, and that's the dismissal of the members of the supervisory board. The dismissal of the board members with the change of government is not possible anymore. That used to be the case before 2010. According to the code, as a starting point of the code, there should be a long-term relationship between the parties of the companies. Each member of the supervisory board is appointed for a maximum period of 4 years and has to be resigned and can be resigned according to a schedule of resignation. The schedule of resignation has to prevent all members from resigning at the same time and guarantee continuity of the board and transfer of knowledge within the board. The dismissal and removal of the board members is only possible and permitted as determined in the Code of Corporate Governance. This is only possible by insufficient functioning of a member, meaning you have to periodically evaluate the functioning of that member. And only if by evaluation you can determine that there is insufficient functioning of a member, he can be dismissed. Dismissal can also take place if there is a structural dispute on inside of the member of the supervisory board and the shareholders meeting. For instance, if you have a utility company and they want the shareholder decides that they want to have more green energy, and this specific member of the supervisory board objects that and keeps telling that he wants to continue with using fossil fuel as energy, that can be determined as structural dispute on insights, and that will be a base to dismiss such a member. Incompatibility of interests is also one of the reasons you can dismiss a member. For instance, if you're in a supervisory board of the telecom company, and you're also in the supervisory board of a competing telecom company, then that is totally incompatible. And you can be dismissed for that. And naturally, you can be dismissed if there's fraud or lack of integrity. I want to finalize by giving you an overview of the code corporate governance. The corporate governance code is subdivided in the following 5 chapters. The general principles, a chapter regarding the tasks and responsibilities of the supervisory board, and 2 other chapters regarding the tasks and responsibilities of the managing directors and the shareholders meeting. And last, there's a chapter regarding the reporting regarding the corporate governance. In general, the corporate governance code embodies principles as well as substantive provisions which the persons and parties involved in the corporations have to observe towards one another. The principle may be interpreted as a general view regarding good corporate governance. These principles have been further elaborated in substantive provisions which create certain standards for the conduct of the managing director, the supervisory director, the shareholders, and external certified public accountants. These provisions may be considered as a further formalization of the general principles of good corporate governance. The corporation may deviate from this code. Deviations are not objectionable in themselves, and they may be even justified under certain circumstances. Being able to apply all the provisions of the corporate governance codes namely depends on the actual circumstances of the corporation and shareholders. The shareholders, as well as the managing board and supervisory board, should be open-minded and favorably inclined to dialogue in which they are respective the reason for deviation. Unconditional deviation, however, from the code is not possible. You have to comply or explain. At last, just by introducing a code corporate governance doesn't mean you will be having good corporate governance in the state-owned enterprises. To have good corporate governance in the state-owned enterprises, you have to educate all parties involved. You have to educate especially the politicians and sure also the members of the boards.